This is Radio Health Journal. I'm Reed Pence. This week, when death becomes life.
And the organ pinks up and starts working. It is just an incredible feeling. So satisfying and special. It's magical.
The miracle of organ transplantation, when Radio Health Journal returns.
I'm Nancy Benson, host of Radio Health Journal. If you enjoy Radio Health Journal, you'll also like our sister show. Here's a preview of what they're covering on Viewpoints this week.
This week on Viewpoints.
These are all seeds of the same poisonous tree of hatred, and now the issue of the Confederate monuments is part of that discussion.
Former New Orleans Mayor Mitch Landrieu discusses the removal of Confederate statues. Then,
the brain needs time down, where you're not putting out energy, but rather taking in energy, recharging. And that's what recess gives a child a chance to do, recharge.
Giving kids that free time to chill out and move. I'm Marty Peterson.
And I'm Gary Price. These stories in depth this week on your public affairs magazine, Viewpoints.
Listen to Viewpoints on your favorite radio station, iTunes and Stitcher.
When Josh Mesrich was a medical student, he wasn't thinking of becoming a surgeon. But on the very first day of his required surgery rotation, he was told to scrub in for a kidney transplant. It was near the end of an extremely long shift. He was exhausted, hungry, and just wanted to go home. But scrub in he did.
And it was this older surgeon, and the classical music was playing. And they got the vessels prepared and took this kidney out of the cooler, and there it was sitting there looking pale and lifeless, and they sewed the blood vessels together and opened the clamps, and in front of my eyes, this thing suddenly turns pink, and within 5 minutes, urine just starts squirting out of the ureter onto our hands, and I just sat there thinking, I can't believe this works, and I was very aware that someone had just died and given this gift. I was very aware that this recipient's life had just changed. And I really wondered, my goodness, could I do this myself? What else can we do this with? How could you do anything that is more exciting and impactful than that? And I will tell you, to this day, no matter how tired I am, when you release those clamps, and of course I always use the stupid line, give my creation life, and the organ pinks up and starts working, it is just an incredible feeling. So satisfying and special. It's magical.
Now Mesrich is associate professor of surgery in the Division of Multiple Transplantation at the University of Wisconsin School of Medicine and Public Health. He's also author of When Death Becomes Life, Notes from a Transplant Surgeon. He gives readers a surgeon's view of the process and pays tribute to the courage of researchers, recipients, and donors who've made transplants possible.
Late 40s into early 1950s was the very beginnings, 1954, when they did the first successful kidney transplant between identical twins, which was done in Boston by Joe Murray. And then from that year up until the late 60s, they were experimenting with non-identical twins, had a few successes but tons of bad outcomes, ultimately had some successes really into the 60s. And transplant became, in my opinion, a legitimate, successful discipline in 1983 when cyclosporin was approved. So when you think about it, it's a field that from the early 1950s to 1983 went from science fiction to reality.
Mesrich was nervous the first time he went to retrieve an organ because he knew he'd have to face the family of the recently deceased donor.
We fly up to this small hospital, and there's this group of people whose loved one has just died unexpectedly. And I thought they would look at us as this group that was taking away their loved one's body parts like vultures. But it couldn't be further from the truth. The donor families usually love talking to us. They love to hear about the donation, to hear about when it will happen, when will the patients get the organs. Will they be able to meet them? They want to tell us something about the person who just died. It really is this one bright spot in this otherwise, you know, terrible tragedy.
Mesrich now cherishes meeting donor families and believes it's one of the most important events in a transplant surgeon's world.
We always do this moment of silence when we do a procurement, and then our organ procurement technician will read something about the donor, maybe a story about them, maybe a poem or a prayer or something the donor family provided. And it really lets us remember what it is we're doing and how this person was giving this gift. And I've spoken to so many donor families that will tell me down the road, you know, that they've really gained a family member, or they really hang on to this very positive kind of legacy of their donor. And we had a picnic for our donors and recipients, and this woman we have a picture of where she was using a stethoscope listening to the heart of her daughter beat in the recipient's chest. Her daughter had died maybe 10 years before in a car accident, and she's actually listening to this piece of her daughter still beating. And I don't know how you don't get goosebumps thinking about that.
Mesrich is an abdominal transplant surgeon. He transplants livers, kidneys, and pancreas, but not hearts or lungs, which are done by thoracic surgeons. He vividly remembers his first transplant as an attending surgeon.
I'd been through all of this training. I had done tons of operations as a trainee, but you always had the attending across from you, or at least being responsible. So even though you felt like you were doing everything, there was always someone else that was looking over your shoulder, that was making the ultimate decision, and that really was going to take responsibility if something goes wrong.
But there's got to be a first time for everything, even for transplant surgeons.
But of course, my first kidney transplant, turns out, was a retransplant, so the patient had had a previous one, and the donor was his wife, and his wife was a nurse, and I just felt really nervous about it and thought, oh, I don't want to do this. So I go into the room to meet the patient, and he and his wife are sitting there, and, you know, there's always a first one, but they happened to ask me on this case. After I explained the operation, the wife, who was a nurse, said, how many of these have you done? And I just thought, oh, I can't believe I got asked that on my very first one. So when I sewed the kidney in, it was hard. It was deep. It was harder than I expected it to be, which is often the case in the beginning. And when I released the clamps and I gave my line, you know, give my creation life, nothing happened. The kidney didn't turn pink. It just sat there flaccid. And my heart was beating a mile a minute.
Mesrich quickly realized his mistake. Not really a problem at all. The retractors were simply pushing down on the blood vessels sewn to the new kidney.
So I took a deep breath and just lifted the retractor up, and all of a sudden the thing turned pink. And that was my first kidney, and ended up going great. It's funny because then I've done so many since, and now no one ever asks how many I've done. So it just would be that the first time I would get asked that. I love the kidney transplant because, of course, in surgery, we always brag about doing these big operations, and there's this ranking of surgeons as to how big your surgery is. But a kidney transplant is a pretty straightforward operation, and it doesn't take that long. And if you do it well, it can be with minimal blood loss. But it really is one of the best things we do. You take someone who's living this miserable life on dialysis, who's not going to live that long, and then you do this operation, and almost with a snap of the fingers, you've changed their life forever. Their life is so much better, they live longer, and it's actually way cheaper. So it's like one of the few things in healthcare that actually checks off all of those boxes.
The pancreas transplant is another operation that creates miracles for recipients, but gets much less publicity.
We traditionally do pancreas transplants for type 1 diabetes, so people that make no insulin. A lot of times type 1 diabetics are diagnosed as children. Now, we don't normally do a pancreas transplant just for the diabetes because a lot of people would think that the medications you have to take to prevent rejection maybe have as many side effects as being on insulin. So typically you would do the pancreas if the patient developed kidney failure because type 1 diabetes causes kidney failure. So at that point we would do a combined pancreas and kidney transplant.
Mesrich says it's difficult for research to show that a pancreas transplant prolongs life any better than insulin shots do. But as to improving quality of life, he says there's no question.
You'll never meet a more thankful patient than a type 1 diabetic who received a pancreas transplant. You think about it, a lot of these patients were diagnosed, I don't know, when they're 10 years old, and their whole life has been about checking their blood sugars, you know, asking their parents if they can eat that piece of cake at a party, waking up in the middle of the night to check blood sugars, always packing both their insulin and some candy, not being able to go do a sleepover at a friend's house. I mean, everything about their life has to be planned out and really, really thought through. And then they get this pancreas transplant, and all of a sudden, they don't have to worry about that anymore. And it's like so freeing for these patients. So I do think it can be one of the most beautiful transplants.
However, sometimes all transplant surgeons must face bad outcomes and complications.
And sometimes you get a bad outcome even though you feel like you did everything right. But sometimes you have to admit that you made an error and that that's why this patient is suffering or even dies. And this is something I write about and I wanted to be honest about. A piece of advice that was given to me is that all surgeons need to have this metaphorical box. And in that box, you can put your complications and you can close that box so that you can go home and be with your family and your kids and not constantly be out of the moment and thinking about all of this. But you also need to be able to open that box and access it so that you can be with the patient and you can own that and you can be honest and work through it. And I know surgeons that can't close the box and they kind of go crazy and are miserable and tend to leave surgery. But I also know surgeons that can't open it and they can become sort of cavalier and it's a bad way to practice. So everyone's got to have their way of dealing with that.
Failure is unfortunate, but Mesrich says we wouldn't be where we are today if the pioneers of transplantation didn't have the courage to fail. But he says they also had the courage to succeed.
They really believed that despite all of the failures, despite all the people around them telling them they were crazy and they were killing people and even, you know, writing petitions to get rid of them, they really believed they were going to succeed. And in many of them, it never would have occurred to them that they wouldn't succeed. I don't think the innovation has stopped, and I do think we're right on the verge of kind of equally giant, exciting innovations in a lot of different areas of medicine, but certainly in transplant. And I think xeno, or transplanting organs from animals, specifically pigs, is going to be on everyone's horizon in the very near future. With advances in gene editing, it's starting to become a reality in animal models, so transplanting, say, a pig kidney into a primate. We already have examples where the organ is surviving for more than a year, even 2 years. So I think we're within a couple of years of human trials using genetically modified pig kidneys into humans. It won't be a home run overnight, but you think about the way transplant moved 10 years from now, that may be a reality.
And that would be a dream come true for the hundreds of thousands of people surviving on dialysis today. You can read more about the miracle of organ transplantation in Joshua Mesrich's book, When Death Becomes Life, available now. You can learn more about all of our guests by visiting our website at radiohealthjournal.net. Our writer-producer this week is Polly Hansen. I'm Reed Pence.
If you or someone you know is struggling with addiction, please call this toll-free number right now. 800-279-0419. That's 800-279-0419. By calling your addiction team, you're taking the first steps to recovery. Don't fight addiction alone. Their advisors are ready to take your call. Your future is still a bright place. The help you need could be one call away. 800-279-0419. That's 800-279-0419. This call is completely confidential. And if you have private insurance, there could be little to no cost to you. Even if you've already been to treatment, give us a call. There's no need to let addiction ruin your life. Take the first step now. Call your addiction team at 800-279-0419. That's 800-279-0419. Make the free call now. 800-279-0419. Your addiction team is a third-party advertiser for various treatment centers and placement networks. Individual results will vary. Visit youraddictionteam.com/terms for more information.
Individuals and businesses with tax problems, listen carefully. Do you feel like you're losing control of your finances? If you owe over $10,000 in back taxes or have unfiled tax returns, we can help you take back control. The IRS is the largest and most aggressive collection agency in the world, and they can seize your bank accounts, garnish your paycheck, close your business, and file criminal charges. Take control of your tax problem now by calling the experts at U.S. Tax Shield and take advantage of the Fresh Start program and new laws
laws that may allow us to negotiate a settlement for the lowest amount possible. Our team of tax attorneys and enrolled agents can stop collections and get you protected so you can take control of your financial future. U.S. Tax Shield offers a price protection guaranteed quote to get you protected today. U.S. Tax Shield is A-plus rated with the Better Business Bureau, so call now. 800-568-1647. That's 800-568-1647. U.S. Tax Shield. 800-568-1647.
What are you going to do with your old car? You can try selling it, you could junk it, or you can donate it to Heritage for the Blind. Your car will be towed away for free, and your donation is tax deductible. Just call 1-800-835-1478. Heritage for the Blind accepts cars, vans, trucks, and boats. It doesn't matter if your vehicle runs or not. It will be towed away for free, and you'll be supporting those that need help. Heritage for the Blind is a nonprofit organization that helps the visually impaired live fuller lives. Call right now to donate your car, and as a special thank you, you'll receive a free 3-day vacation voucher to over 50 locations. Call Heritage for the Blind right now. Call 1-800-835-1478. Donating is easy, and your vehicle is towed away for free. Plus, you'll get a free vacation voucher for donating. Call now, 1-800-835-1478. That's 1-800-835-1478.
And that's Radio Health Journal for this week. Radio Health Journal is a production of MediaTrax Communications. Follow us on Facebook and Twitter, and check iTunes for a library of past programs. Plus, you'll always find podcasts of our segments, information about our guests, and the latest health news at RadioHealthJournal.net. Join us again next week for another edition of Radio Health Journal.